Welcome. Today we're at the Kettle's Yard Gallery in Cambridge, and we're meeting Alan Blackwell. And Alan Blackwell is going to tell us about visual representation and how we can use it when designing engaging products. So, Alan, what is visual representation?
Well, this is an ideal place to explain it. This is the house that belonged to Jim Ede, who was the first curator of modern art at the Tate Gallery in London. His house here in Cambridge, he used his personal collection to explain to Cambridge students about theories of art and of painting. So on his walls, we have examples like this painting by Christopher Wood of a snow scene in Paris.
So you chose this painting, but why did you choose it? Why didn't you choose a photo which seemed to be a better representation?
Sure. So there are other ways I could use technology to give us an impression of where we are. So I could use Google Earth to look at Paris, for example, or I could come right here on Google Maps. Mm-hmm. And we could say, here we are at this house.
Seems to be more accurate.
Well, yes, but a map is one kind of an image of a place, and it doesn't really give you an idea of what it's like to be here. So to some extent, he's giving you a picture of what it's like to be here. But of course, with technology, we could do much better than that. We could take a photograph, and this is a great image showing just what it was like to be here. Mm-hmm. So the question is, why didn't he make something as good as a photograph? Because surely already Leonardo da Vinci or Michelangelo or Rembrandt, they could already make very realistic paintings. Mm-hmm. So why are we here looking at this painting that just seems to be a not very good painting of Paris? Well, I'm going to show you some other paintings here to explain what it was that he was achieving.
Yeah, so let's go have a look. So, so Alan, this painting looks like it's been drawn by someone without an artistic training.
Yeah, so this is a painting, all these paintings are by Alfred Wallis, mm-hmm. Who was a fisherman in Cornwall, where this early 20th century St. Ives school of British painters were based, including Christopher Wood, whose painting of Paris in the Snow we've just seen. So Wood discovered Wallis's work, and they were very impressed because of the way that he had managed to represent aspects of Cornwall life that, as professionally trained painters, they hadn't managed to. Mm-hmm. If you look at this, though, the perspective is extremely unusual.
It is.
It looks almost childish, in fact. But there are no real rules about perspective. Perspective is any system by which you take a two-dimensional surface and use it to represent a three-dimensional scene. So the camera picture that I took of you just before, mm-hmm. That's camera lens perspective, and it's a particular distinct way. Those artists, Leonardo da Vinci and so on, they had their own schemes. At most periods in history, there have been different kinds of perspective. Wallis was completely self-taught, and he invented his own perspective, invented it in much the same way that children do, to show the things that are important and the things that interest him. And in fact, you can instantly recognize when you go to Penzance Harbor, you can recognize where this is, you can see what kind of lighthouse this is, you can see what kind of ships these are. Most importantly, you can see something that's very characteristic about his life as a fisherman, that he was remembering as he sat at his kitchen table after he retired, drawing pictures like this from memory. Hmm. Here we can see a ship coming in stormy waters on a dangerous day through a stone sea break. And it's an exciting, thrilling, probably dangerous and worrying experience. If you've been in a ship in those sorts of conditions, the ship is tilting to the side. That piece of perspective is showing you just what you need to know to understand what Wallis is representing. Which he's not representing a place, he's representing a memory. What he's showing us here is the authentic memory of a fisherman experiencing being in the situation and not being childish, actually showing us with a novel, sophisticated kind of perspective, exactly the kinds of ideas that he wants to communicate. Hmm.
So how do you take these principles and apply them when designing technical products?
Well, in fact, this is directly relevant to something like the scene that we see on the screen of our computer when you see the Microsoft Windows screen or the Macintosh or the Xerox Star. What they do, as this system does, this painting does, they're representations of the important things. Some of them are memories, some of them are ideas, and they're arranged on the screen that shows you the things that are important. They're a kind of perspective, but not a pictorial perspective. Mm. So we need to be aware of those options, the ways that we can arrange the graphical elements in our two-dimensional scene to carry different meanings. So there are other paintings in the collection here that show us other ways of arranging marks.
Mm-hmm.
Shall we go and see how that can be done?
Definitely. Okay, so Alan, what are the graphical techniques on this portrait which we can use when designing?
So this is a great example of something that would be very easy to do on a computer in one way, because it's just simple black and white. It's mm-hmm. just done with black ink and a brush. But you can see the ways that those simple marks are conveying so much, partly because we can detect the expression. The brush stroke here sweeping around the eye gives you a force of personality coming out through the spectacles of the poet Ezra Pound, who mm-hmm. Subject to this portrait by Henri Gaudier-Brzeska. Or the playful little twiddle, the thread on the bottom of his beard. So the fact that we can detect the evidence of the brushstrokes, this is what tells us that we have personality here, that we're communicating human to human. It's not just a set of machine marks. So in fact, it's not that easy to achieve with a computer. One of the things we want to be thinking about is when we put marks on the screen, where is the humanity that we can detect and mm-hmm. the kind of marks that we use? So there's another painting also by Gaudier-Brzeska over here where mm-hmm. we can see a completely different set of marks.
Yeah, let's have a look.
Okay. We can see that he's made a two-dimensional picture of a three-dimensional object. He's not using perspective, but there's a lot of very machine-like straight lines here.
Mm-hmm.
These marks are a clue to the reader based on our knowledge of previous technologies. So because we know about the history of copper plate etching and printing, we know that when you see straight lines like that, this is the way that you represent shadows in a drawing. So we can interpret what the three-dimensional object is because we see the conventional depiction of shadows. And when you're designing visual representations, you need to know about history of representation in order to tell your audience, give them the cues of how they're to read the thing that they see on the surface.
Hmm. So what is this?
Well, in fact, the object that this is a representation of is also right here in the museum. So let's go and take a look at it.
Yeah, sure. So this is the object, the sculpture we saw on the drawing.
That's right. Gaudier-Brzeska was making a drawing of his own sculpture, mm-hmm. and you can see that he's made a very good job. The lines that we saw have given us a two-dimensional visual representation, which has very clearly depicted the three-dimensional shape of this object.
Mm-hmm. But still, it's a little bit difficult to see what it is.
Ah, well, of course, this sculpture is also a representation.
Mm-hmm.
Perhaps as a clue, I could tell you its name is Bird Swallowing Fish.
Mm-hmm.
So this is a sculpture of a bird swallowing a fish. Although even that is a little hard to see. For many years, I wasn't clear which part was the bird and which was the fish, but there's a clue here. Here we have the bird's foot.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, it doesn't resemble the foot of any bird that
but
you know.
But I can see it's a bird's foot.
Precisely, so, yeah. It's a symbol of a bird's foot. It's completely generic, and this is telling us, this shape is saying, this is a bird. But of course, there's a lot of other interesting symbolism here. For example, why is the fish? The fish actually doesn't look very much like a fish.
It's and it comes from above.
Well, yeah, that's right. This shape is like the shape of a torpedo or a hand grenade.
Sure.
He was working around the time of the First World War, so the fact that we have a very violent scene in which a fish is looking like a hand grenade is meaningful. And there's a lot of ambiguity. How come we've got a bird that's coming from below and a fish coming from above? I mean, this is the opposite of the real world.
Mm-hmm.
And in fact, as a representation, the ambiguity is about which part is which. Are inspiring a research project, a sculptor who's working with me right now, and we're working on the digital morphing of animal shapes. And that whole project was inspired by this sculpture because of when he saw it, what he saw was one animal becoming another animal. So the symbolism here is a combination of ambiguity of interpretation, specific symbols, and there's a lot of meaning that can be read out of this object.
So visual representation is actually all about symbolism, you could say.
Absolutely. Sometimes it's done well and sometimes it's done badly. So as an example, one software project that I was involved with, they wanted an icon to represent the button you should click to change what you're working on.
Mm-hmm.
And what they did was, in English, the word change means modifying something, but it's also a pile of coins like this.
Yeah, of course.
The icon they used on the button was a pile of coins to indicate this is the button you should use to change your work.
Quite confusing.
So if you don't speak English, of course, that picture is not meaningful at all. So symbols are about correspondences. This is a correspondence to the fish of, to the foot of a bird. This is a correspondence to war. And visual puns are correspondences. We can use all of these things when we design visual representations for technology. Some are good and some are bad. It depends on what the people who are going to be seeing our displays understand.
So what is the correspondence between the sculpture and the drawing?
Well, the drawing we saw upstairs, you might think that a sculptor, when preparing to make a sculpture, would maybe make some drawings in advance to figure out what it ought to look like.
Yeah, that's quite normal.
Although, in fact, the drawing we saw upstairs looks rather more like it's a drawing of this sculpture that he made afterwards. But we can settle that question because there's another drawing here, a drawing that Gaudier-Brzeska made as he was preparing
as a sketch.
Yeah. Absolutely. So let's take a look at that one. Okay, so this preparatory sketch of the bird swallowing the fish, in fact, it is a representation of a very distinctive incident in Gaudier-Brzeska's life. He was sitting by the Serpentine Lake in Hyde Park in London, and he saw the actual event. He saw a bird swallowing a live fish. And the drama of that event is captured in a very small number of pencil lines in this sketch. The vorticist movement that he was part of, their main priority was to capture expressive movement in art. So with only a few lines, you can see precisely what it was, the dynamic that he has captured in the sculpture. So this is one of the other real values of visual representation, is that there were many things going on that day in Hyde Park. There was grass, there was sky, there was other people sitting around, there were probably waves. There's many other things in his sculpture. There's the texture of the bronze and so on. But when we make a visual representation, it's possible to abstract away all of those things and convey simply the essentials. And this means that visual representations can be a tool for conceptualization, for analysis, and for making plans about what we intend to do. So those things also are true of technology, that we use visual representations to remove the complexity of scenes that we would see in a photograph or a literal representation.
Okay, so Alan, thanks for your time, and it's been really interesting to hear about visual representation. I would like to know more, so I thought maybe we could go for some more detailed talking about visual representation. What do you think about that?
Sure, that's fine. The museum's closing now.
Yeah, so we have to go.
So we have to leave here. Before we go, though, one last puzzle for you.
Mm-hmm.
That's this object here. So what's being represented here? Well, I won't keep you in suspense. It's called St. Edmund, St. Edmund was the first patron saint and king of England. But in fact, no sculptor made this. It was made by a bolt of lightning hitting a willow tree near the river here in Cambridge.
Really? Artistic lightning?
That's right. So somebody found it and brought it here into the museum as a gift for Jim Ede. So what is it a representation of? A representation of St. Edmund, or possibly it's just a representation of a lightning strike.
Hmm.
Shall we go?
Yeah, let's go.